Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of The Atheist Experience. I'm your host, Ashley Perrien, and my co-host this week, Linda Raymond. Thank
afternoon.
You very much. I was not here last week. I was actually out of town enjoying a well-deserved break from the show and from life in general. Having a good time doing it, but definitely glad to be back in the seat. Anyway, it's July 18th. We are live at the Atheist Experience. We're being sponsored by the Atheist Community of Austin, a nonprofit educational organization promoting positive atheism and separation of church and state. We have weekly meetings every Sunday at Crescent City Beignets, which is on 6th Street, a couple blocks west of Lamar. That's every Sunday, starts around 11:30 or so. And that's just all of us getting together, talking, just sitting around a table, just having a good time socializing. It's not a highly structured, organized meeting or anything like that. It's just, like I say, people getting together, having a good time. It's open to any atheists and atheist-friendly people. You don't have to be a member of the group to come, but you're more than welcome to come down, show up, and say hi and meet some of the crew. It's a good time. Other things that we normally do, also, every Thursday, we have Atheist Happy Hour at Antonio's Tex-Mex, which is a couple blocks south of 183 on the southbound feeder of I-35. That's every Thursday starting at 7:30 in the evening. And again, that's just like the Sunday meeting, just a whole bunch of people sitting around a table having a good time. Also, I forgot to mention, we have the Crescent City Beignets every Sunday, save the third Sunday of every month, when we have our lecture series at the Austin History Center on 9th and Guadalupe. Today being the third Sunday, we did have a lecture. We were supposed to have somebody come in from the ACLU to talk about some of the history of the First Amendment and how it applies to religion. Apparently something happened to where they couldn't show up, and we had Don Baker and a couple other members of the ACA were there, and they gave us updates on how the textbook hearings are going. Basically, the state of Texas has hearings every year on different brands of textbooks, different subjects textbooks, and they have hearings on whether or not they should be accepted or rejected for schools. And right now, they're reviewing health textbooks, which include sex education. And the religious right has already gotten a hold of those and basically stripped out anything in them regarding preventative safety or contraception or anything like that. It's basically don't have sex, that's the end of the story, next chapter, please. There are a lot of people who are signing up to say, look, we need to have talk about condoms in there. We need to have talk about all these different kind of sex education issues. Kids need to know this stuff. It's more than just abstinence. Abstinence doesn't work all that well. We're having hearings on that. They had one, I believe it was about a week ago. I want to say it was on
Wednesday.
No, it was actually on Wednesday, the 14th. And the next one I want to say is in a couple of months.
It's in September.
Oh, it's in September? Mm-hmm. Okay. And I think the final hearing is in...
I believe it's also in September, less than a week after the second hearing. But I'm not convinced
of that. No, the actual final vote, I remember they were saying it's right after the election. November 5th,
okay,
or something like that, I want to say. Around the beginning of November, right after the election, they're going to have the vote on whether or not to actually accept these books as is, or say, we need to go back and have them rewritten and have stuff added into them. Like I say, right now, as far as I know, they have very little talk about contraception or anything in them.
Actually, one of the books has a line that says that barrier protection is not 100% effective against STDs. And that's about the sum total of any comments about condoms. But they do give you the advice to be well rested before sex so you will not make stupid decisions.
Okay. There you go.
That is actual quote from the thing.
Did they ever say anything about the failure rates of condoms versus abstinence?
No, just that thing that how they're not 100% specific against STDs.
Okay.
But the CDC has just apparently recently released a report about abstinence versus condoms. Guess which wins?
And who is a CDC?
The Center for Disease Control.
Oh, okay. Chances are abstinence wasn't the one.
Well, it's only abstinence, of course, wins as long as one practices it.
Assuming it is used effectively, then yes.
Yes, but when it comes to going on in life and actually living a life where you're not going to get pregnant and you're not going to have an STD, people who are actually taught about condoms and contraceptives just wins hand down. They're the ones who aren't going to die from AIDS.
Yeah, yeah. It would be very interesting to see, because I know condoms are supposed to be very effective, again, when used correctly.
Right.
Abstinence is the best you can get when used effectively. Its failure rate, though, is pretty bad. And if you do fail, it's really going to screw you up.
What is a 100% failure rate if you fail at all?
Good point. All right. But anyway, that was Don Baker and a couple other members this morning talking about the hearings on that. Thank them very much for standing up and taking that over. Also, other regular events that we do, I mentioned Happy Hour, the Nonprofits Internet Audio Show, which is every other Saturday at atheistnetwork.com. They just had one yesterday, and so the next one will be in 2 weeks, which is, what, July 31st. That is, it's again, it's a live show, Atheist Network, 2 to 3:30, every other Saturday. It's a good time. It's a lot of news and analysis and just talk from an atheist perspective.
And of course, they also have the online chat, so you can actually chat to them while they're on air.
Yes, yes. There's a good chat feature, so you can go actually go onto the site, sign into the chat, and talk to other people while you're there. That's hosted by our own Jeff D., co-hosted by Dennis Lube, and producer is Russell Glaster, another one of our co-hosts. And I believe they every now and then have guests, whoever happens to be around. I think Mary was on a week or two ago.
As they say, whoever shows up gets to be a guest.
Exactly. But it's a great show. It's definitely worth listening to. It's a live MP3 stream. Okay, that is pretty much what we have in terms of announcements, I believe. We can go ahead and put the phone number up now. We're going to get calls to pretty soon. But there is something I wanted to go over first. A couple weeks back, this was actually maybe a month ago or so, we had a call from one of the very early hosts of this show, Ray Blevins. He had called, said that he was doing some tax forms for a friend or something like that, and he saw something about them saying that you can have some kind of exemption or whatever it is for Christian Scientists, and he was asking if we knew anything about that or details. Well, I found it out. And talk about jumping down the rabbit's hole. There is an application for exemption from self-employment tax for use by ministers, member of religious orders, and Christian Science practitioners. Now, this is only, from my understanding, which I'm no tax lawyer, is if you're self-employed, and this is an exemption to where you do not have to pay income tax on the money that you make that is directly related to, in what we're talking about today, if you're a Christian Science practitioner. So if I am a qualified Christian Science practitioner and I go somewhere and I earn, you know, $50 or whatever, you know, treating someone, then I don't have to pay income tax on that $50. Now, it's kind of a strange thing, but...
May I see that?
I looked at it. That's the actual tax form. It boils down to, here's actually the description of the exemption. A Christian Science practitioner, upon filing an application, together with a statement that either he is consciously opposed to, or because of religious principles he is opposed to, the acceptance of any public insurance, which makes payments in the event of death, disability, old age, or retirement, or makes payments towards the cost of, or provides services for, medical care, shall receive an exemption from the tax imposed by this chapter with respect to services performed by him, such as minister, member, or practitioner. So apparently it's also got something in there about insurance. So I'm assuming it's some kind of Social Security type.
Social Security and Medicare, since they're not allowed to receive, they're certifying they will not take funds from those, those sections, then they're not paying into them.
Exactly. Which, in a sense, almost sounds fair, but I wish everybody could do that. I would like to say, look, I promise I won't take anything from Social Security, for instance. So can I not pay into it? Apparently they can do that. Anyone else can't. Christian Scientists, ministers, members of religious orders can do that. So that was that. But I knew I had read that Christian Science were just some plain old wacky people. So I did a little bit of research on them to find out what it is that they think of. And, man, they've got some wacko ideas. I'll go over some things here. It was actually founded by Mary Baker Eddy, and she was born 1821 to 1910. She was a lady who had some form of a, what was it?
Delusion?
Well, that too. Suffered from a form of paralysis most of her life. In 1886, after reading accounts of Christ's healing of a man from man with a form of the palsy, Eddie recovered almost instantly. And that was actually Matthew 9, 1 through 8. And basically it's just Jesus cured this man of the palsy and everyone else around him doubted it, saying, this man comes along and says, you're not actually sick. What is it? I'll actually go ahead and read it, why not? And he entered unto a ship and passed over and came into his own city. And behold, there brought him a man sick of the palsy, lying in a bed. And Jesus, seeing their faith, said unto the sick of the palsy, son, be of good cheer, thy sins be forgiven thee. And behold, certain of the scribes said within themselves, this man blasphemeth. And Jesus knoweth their thoughts and said, why do you think you're evil, blah, 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 blah. Basically, but that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins. Arise, take up thy bed, and go into thy house. And he did. Essentially, the important one here was your sins are forgiven, therefore you're healed. They've taken that idea and run with it. They're of the idea that anything bad in this world is not real. Anything that is real is God. God is the only might or mind. God is all in all and the divine principle of all that really is. The all-knowing, seeing, acting, wise, loving, and eternal. The inspired word of the Bible is accepted as sufficient guide to eternal life. Let me see. Christian scientists commonly rely wholly on the power of God for healing rather than on medical treatment. Healing is not held to be miraculous, but divinely natural. Disease is understood to be basically a mental concept that can be dispelled by active Christian discipleship, spiritual regeneration, and the application of truths to which Jesus bore witness. Diseases aren't real. People are not actually made of bones, blood, skin, plasma, brains, and other gooey stuff. None of that is actually real. So when you break your leg, it's not because bones are broken, nerves are severed, you're spewing blood that it hurts. It's that you haven't prayed hard enough. You're not a good enough Christian. And therefore, some of God's will has left that part of your body, and now you're feeling the lack of goodness, the lack of God.
Well, and don't forget the codicil to that, that if you have not heard of a disease, you can't actually come down with it. They actually believe, if you're ignorant of AIDS, if you've never heard of AIDS, well, you can't get it, because it's being familiar with the disease is how you open up your soul to it.
Now, actually, now that you're just saying that, though, I'm kind of thinking that it's not technically correct. I don't know about that.
Actually, that's Mary Baker Eddy's own words from the prose writings in one of those books I had given you.
Okay, all right. Okay, so I didn't read all the books. Shoot me. what I have this other article here that talks about basically their whole ideals and beliefs and everything like that. And they had some landmark cases against the Christian scientists in the early 1900s. One judge ruled that healers must confine themselves to influence the patient's mind and not use agencies of the flesh or any methods that would put him in competition with physicians. Since then, it has been expedient for the Christian Science Church to claim total independence of practice of medicine. No longer does the church tell its practitioners to doctor infectious or contagious diseases. Indeed, the church neither limits the diseases its practitioners may treat, nor indicates any duty to refer, although the entire training for practitioners consists 2 weeks of religious instruction. Two whole weeks of religious instruction.
And then they're turned loose on the general population.
Exactly.
All right.
To go out and heal the masses. And essentially, to maintain its independence from the state, the church even forbids its nurses to give any physical application beyond the normal measures of cleanliness. Because if they started to say, let's actually do something to heal somebody, then they'd be technically in competition with physicians. Can't do that. They could get brought to court.
And is that prohibition still to these days, or is it only at the early part of last century?
No, I believe that this is current.
Wow.
Christian Science rejects not only drugs, but even the simplest human measures for relieving suffering or discomfort, such as hot packs, ice packs, enemas, and back rubs. Its nurses cannot recognize the reportable diseases, take a pulse, or use a fever thermometer.
You see, this is something that I've mentioned to you, and that's exactly what actually killed one of my dad's coworkers. She had bought herself a new pair of shoes. This was back in the 70s. My dad said she was something like a mid-30s, 40 years old, fully functional adult. The new shoes actually gave her a blister, which she refused to treat. She died of it less than 6 weeks later when it became infected. She did not treat it, no bandage, no Bactine, not even letting it air out. These people are insane.
Yeah. Got infected, and it killed her.
Correct. Yeah, it was just blood poisoning, whatever. Because, I mean, she had never had tetanus shots. She had never had penicillin. She had never even had aspirin any once in her whole life.
Wow.
And she is dead. She has been dead all these years because she did not believe the blister could hurt her.
Because it wasn't real.
Yes, wrong.
Yeah, very much so. Yeah, I mean, these people have just some wacky ideas. Now, I did find something funny here. I'll read this kind of as a little aside. This was actually, I found it surfing the web looking for some of their ideas. Some of their writings and whatnot. This is actually by a very Christian website. I think it's ondoctrine.com or something like that. The early parts kind of give a factual idea of what they believe and whatnot, but then later on it turns out that it's extremely biased against them. So these lines you'll have to take with a grain of salt that they deserve. But these are Christians saying that these people are just plain wacky. Look in the mirror. There is a saying that grape nut cereal, which is neither grape or nuts, is like Christian Science, which is neither Christian nor science. Christian Science claims to be Christian, but denies every teaching about Jesus Christ found in the Bible, including his own words about himself. Christian Science claims to be science, but denies the reality of matter and the universe. Therefore, it makes a scientific method impossible to use. It's not quite that bad, but they are definitely off kilter.
I'd argue with you, it is that bad. She actually says that her idea of science is understanding the mind of God, and that is the sum total of everything scientific in the world. And the mind of God is everything that's not physical, no matter.
Yes. Yeah, so matter is not,
yeah, so, I mean,
not real in a sense.
No, it doesn't exist. If something is true, then it cannot be physical because it has to be a part of the mind of God. Something that's physical has to be, by definition, false.
So I can't remember what philosopher it was a while ago, but essentially what he did was, in a completely separate argument, he kicked a big rock and said, "I refute it thus."
Him, yes.
I haven't heard their argument against something like that, and that's not exactly the most philosophically sound argument in the world, but we know reality exists. If a big rock falls down and hits you on the head, you're gonna die. There's no belief, power, or prayers that are going to stop that.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but did you get to the part of the history of how she died? Or I should say, rather, what she did when she died?
I know that she saw a doctor, but I'm not...
She said that her body should be left untouched for something like, well, as long as it could be, and she was actually going to resurrect herself. If I recall right, it finally started rotting after 3 weeks, or something like in the winter. So when she finally began stinking and swelling up enough, they decided that perhaps she's not going to be coming back, and they finally got rid of it. So I mean, even her death gives the lie to her own philosophy, and yet people come back and believe in her.
Yeah. And the main problem that I have with these people, I mean, if you're one person, you have some kind of wacky belief that says, I can't go to a doctor because I think praying is going to heal me. That's fine. You're nuts. You know, you're completely ludicrous. But if you don't want to go to a doctor, you know, when you have a broken leg or, you know, you have an infection or something like that, and you want to, you know, essentially kill yourself through lack of care, you know, if you're an adult and you're competent, that's your choice, good or bad as it may be. The problem is that these people are allowed to have kids. And a lot of, I won't say a lot, but there are lots and lots of cases that have come up where kids with very preventable, if not curable, diseases have died just by not getting a penicillin shot, by not getting the injection of insulin or whatever. There were a couple stories I read of kids who were taken out of school because they had some kind of problem with their leg. A couple months later, Child Protective Services goes out to the school, goes out to the house, finds the kid in bed with a tumor the size of a basketball hanging off their leg. And the parents had never even bothered to consult the doctor about this. They just have one of their practitioners come in, pray over the kid for a little while, and see what happens. Usually they die. There have been a couple instances of things like that. I mean, a kid, again, dies because he didn't get insulin shots.
But, you know, it's also more basic than that. Did you know there's actually a provision in Texas law that if a parent has strong religious feelings, he doesn't have to have his kids inoculated before they go to school?
Yeah.
And in Utah, they actually passed a law just earlier this year that if a child dies because of a lack of medical, the parents are not legally neglectful for having done that.
Yeah.
As long as one doctor came in and said that this child is not going to die within 36 hours, even if he does die within 36 hours, if it was a religious conviction, parents are off scot-free.
Yeah. And there was a lot of talk in the articles I saw where ignorance essentially is what's promoted.
Oh, absolutely.
In their documentation, they say, again, there's no medical training at all, period. They have documents that they put out to their, you know, members and families saying, if your kid is neglected, then you have the duty to report that to the state. They don't bother to give the definition of neglect. And so lack of medical care, they don't know that that is considered negligence. So it's just willful ignorance, essentially, is what they're doing. And there's lots of things in there that are saying, if you know that somebody has a disease, then a Christian Science practitioner can't tend to them, essentially. You know, can't tend to their body. But if they just don't know that there's a disease and they just think that, ooh, it's a demon, or it's, you know, they haven't prayed enough, then essentially that ignorance means that, well, we didn't know that they had a disease called, you know, the flu. And so they don't have to take them in, and they're okay. Now, again, I'm not too sure of the details on that, because ignorance of the law is not immunity of the law.
True,
I can't kill somebody and say, I didn't know it wasn't legal.
But religious people get all sorts of breaks, just all over. I don't know if there's any in federal laws. I'm just familiar with some of the state laws.
Yeah.
But, you know, by that reasoning, that means a child can be treated for chickenpox, but not for cancer. Because they can see the chickenpox, but they don't see the cancer. Well, except for that horrible thing you just described.
Yeah. So, again, they are extremely scary people, mostly because, again, there have been lots of cases of children involved with this. Who have died from very simple things, or things that could have been treated very early on and not really been a big, big problem. But again, their lack of bothering to care for the kids and just saying, let's pray over them for a little while, is what killed them. And that's obviously where we have big, big, big problems. Anyway, we have got callers lined up. We will go ahead and take them. Again, we have about a little over an hour left. We're live call-in show, The Atheist Experience. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, snide remarks, anything like that, give us a call. We'll see what we can do. First, we've got Jay. How you doing?
Hello.
Hey.
About 2 or 3 weeks ago, something was asked on your program, and I didn't get in to respond or ask you the question.
Okay.
And let me go in a circle, because it's going to sound stupid, I guess. I don't know.
Okay.
But I've always, when they came up and brought all the same-sex marriage up, it had to be done usually by a minister or a man that is not really in the, I say, religious field, but it's JP. Okay.
Okay.
Now, if atheists are married, you don't believe in a minister, do atheist couples go to JP? And if that's true, then if two people of the same sex went to him, it's all men's laws are saying that atheists could get married there because they're not believing in the Bible. Two gay people go there, they could believe in the Bible, but they could be married by the JP.
Well, I don't see why Justice of the Peace couldn't marry them. I know some atheists are married in religious ceremonies. That's usually done for families. The family wants to have the big wedding in the church and the white dress and walking down the aisle and all that kind of stuff. And so a couple couples, you know, may very well go through all of that just for everybody else's sake. But having non-religious services through a Justice of the Peace is...
But what I'm saying is, as long as it's not the same sex... has nothing to do with religion if you go to the JP. You see what I'm saying?
So what you're saying is justification is just a non-religious service?
Yes.
Okay. So what does that have to do with a gay marriage?
Because they would deny it and say because the religious cult would say, actually, they don't believe
yeah.
that a gay couple should be. So all it is, it comes back to the little holy Bible of written at that way and saying who and who can't be married. You know that.
Yeah.
And this is something that I was thinking about when the girl or whoever it was that called in the other day, she said that when they started this up in Massachusetts with the same-sex marriages, that was an abomination and sin and everything else going against whoever was doing it.
Yeah.
Because they didn't believe in the Bible. So...
yeah. Well, then all the justice of the pieces are condemned to hell.
Well,
and I'm going to be leading them the way down, most likely.
But that also exposes a very common Christian prejudice that the only real marriage is one that takes place inside a church. They honestly don't understand that you are legally married if you go through a secular authority like a JP or like a judge. And they forget that they themselves have a secular item called a marriage certificate, which they had to secure before their own little voodoo cult there could join them in matrimony.
Well, no, wait a minute.
Yeah.
If you, as a male and female, and you go register in a motel, legally as Mr. and Mrs., that becomes what they call a common law marriage.
Not in every state of the union.
Not in every state, and I think you have to present yourself as a married couple for a certain amount of time. I think you can do. I think that's legal in Texas.
It is.
But
it
I think
is.
You have to do it for 7 years. If you're living together and you're introducing yourself and you're living as if you were married for 7 years, then essentially that's a common law marriage, and by all intents and purposes, you are married according to the state. But like I say, it's not just one time registering a motel. It's for multiple years that you have to live like that. So.
Well, I just was thinking that, and I know you were talking about Jehovah's Witness and other stuff. I know.
Yeah, okay.
Because I've got people that were members of that, and they didn't treat anybody. In fact, almost my father was a Jehovah's Witness until he got cancer. Then he found out that it didn't do any good.
Okay, yeah. So, Jehovah's Witness are another scary bunch who are pretty similar to Christian scientists.
So he's become, before he passed away, he got to something that was natural, plus being a regular, with going to a regular medical doctor to treat it, but it was too late by the time they got to him.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I thank you.
Okay, thank you very much for calling. I believe they had the case up in Canada, maybe a year and a half ago or something like that, where I think it was a Jehovah's Witness family. The daughter had some kind of disease where she needed a blood transplant or a marrow transplant, and the Jehovah's Witness completely against it, can't have blood from, you know, another animal or something in you. The father finally went to the doctor and said, you know, look, I take custody of my child and I say, you know, do what's necessary to save her. Not only did the family and the church completely shun him and reject him, and this was an area of you know, the country or something where there were a lot of Jehovah's Witnesses, so he essentially was exiled from culture, essentially, at that point. He was completely rejected by society. Even his daughter turned against him.
The one who survived?
The one who was saved.
The one who wanted to go and be with God?
Yeah, the one who apparently was just willing to die turned against him, essentially, for that kind of thing. It's just horrifying what these people believe.
How old was the girl? I don't remember this, really.
I don't remember. I want to say it was early teens. Maybe like 12, 13, 14, something like that.
God, they brainwashed him so early.
I can't remember, but I think it was low teens like that. We have got Susan. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Not too bad. If you have your TV on in the background, either turn it off or turn it down.
Okay.
Okay. What you got for us?
Well, actually, it was more of a comment.
Okay.
Basically, I am an atheist, and I've been watching the show for several weeks, and I really appreciate you getting out the atheist opinion.
Okay.
In public, and I think that's important. But one thing that concerns me is I think the perspective that's presented on the show is very positivistic and kind of exclusive. And, you know, I think especially in the discussion of Christian scientists and the influence of other types of explanations about health, it just seems like you might be able to bring a more inclusive perspective to that. I mean, what do you think about non-Western medicines? And just because people take their children to doctors doesn't mean there's going to be a solution.
No, that's absolutely. But if they have some kind of sickness that just waiting a couple days or a week doesn't get them over it, then it may be something where you might want to at least, you know, consult the doctor and say, look, you know, here's what's going on. What do you think? Versus just once you see a lump growing off their leg that's the size of a grapefruit, praying over that's not going to do anything.
And also, the alternative medicine wouldn't matter because they wouldn't even be willing to do that.
Now, granted, that's still the same thing as medicine.
Correct. They would not so much as, was it heat ginseng to help cool the body? They wouldn't follow acupuncture. They wouldn't follow any of the Chinese herbals. They would not take anything that was not just normal food. Yeah. Now, I suppose somebody who's clever could actually slip some food into there, but they themselves will not do that if they know it will help cure.
Yeah. Well, that's true, but I mean, the point that I'm making is really broader because I'm talking about the idea that atheism, as presented on this show, doesn't have what I see as respect for other belief systems, and it's exclusive.
Yeah,
because
if you think about it
outside the context of Christian scientists, you use the example of Chinese medicine, but there are many Eastern religions that do believe in deities that aren't Christian-based, but they wouldn't be in line with the atheism that you're presenting here.
Yeah. Going back to, I guess, your broader point of just general, alternative health in some way. We can all switch the camera over sometime. Sorry. Thank you. other ideas of health. I'm sorry, I don't know if you hung up or you got cut off. If you had any questions, you can give us a call back. Sorry about that. In terms of alternate health remedies, and Eastern medicines, New Age, that type of thing, we treat that in the same thing. Basically, it's a skeptical outlook on the world. Have these things gone through any kind of clinical trials to determine whether or not they're actually effective? Now, some of them definitely have a placebo effect in terms of you take this thing, you think it's going to make you feel better, and therefore you do to a certain extent. A lot of cold remedies work. I won't say they're placebos. They actually help the symptoms. They get you over the coughing and the headaches and the drowsiness and whatnot. But they don't actually cure the root problem. That's something that, you know, it's a virus. We can't cure it. We just have to kind of ride it out. Some of the more Eastern health things, acupuncture comes to mind and that type of thing, haven't shown to really be, to have any basis in actual science. There's nothing solid behind them to back them up and show that this actually works. Again, is it placebo effect? Is it, what is it? We're not too sure. A lot of times it can just be pure chance. You're going to remember that you get some hits. If you start sticking pins in somebody, a couple of them may very well, you know, be healed. If they have a cold, you give them a week, they're going to get better. And so you're going to remember that and say, well, I got some acupuncture, maybe that's what did it. Well, maybe not. And so there could be other explanations. It's something to be skeptical of, just like anything in Western medicine. Be skeptical of it. If there's studies out there showing that aspirin actually helps with a headache, then we have proof. We have some kind of documentation showing that there's good evidence and good studies behind it to back it up. Homeopathy, completely bunk. It's been disproved several times. Homeopathy does absolutely nothing. And given that, it's still selling. Don't know why.
But also, to address her point that we're kind of exclusive here, only addressing Christianity, well, it's because that's what we're surrounded by. If we sit here and we say that the Lutherans have this silly doctrine and the Methodists have this silly doctrine and the Jehovah's Witnesses have this, people in the U.S., in Texas, and in Austin will understand that. But if we say, well, did you hear about that doctrinal difference between the Pure Land Buddhists and the Zen Buddhists? That is going to go so far over people's heads because that's just not in our everyday culture here. So we just don't have to worry about that.
Yeah. But a wider point, most religions we do disagree with. I mean, Buddhism is the one where I could almost say it makes more sense than some of the others. It's got True. Some meditation techniques and things in it that are good synonyms, I guess, and can actually help a person.
If you go only by their physical practices, one could say that. But the instant you get into their doctrine, their reincarnation, the fact that you can't get to heaven unless you spent at least one lifetime as a male, little things like that. Susan's called back, by the way.
Okay.
But so Buddhism, as a philosophy, is good. As a practice, I think, leaves a great deal to be as a practice is fine. As a philosophy, it leaves a great deal to be desired.
Yeah, yeah. But yeah, Christianity is what we mostly hear about, so that's usually what we're going after. But yeah, all the religions have some wackiness to them. Anyway, I think we have Susan back. You there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hey, sorry about that. I'm not too sure what happened.
Sorry. Yeah, I guess what my broader point is that our culture is multicultural and diverse.
Yeah.
And so one of the things that I'm interested in is how people can get along. And the way that they get along is based on their ideals and beliefs and their values. And for a lot of people, those are based on religion. And so to me, sometimes when you say things like, well, these are just wacky ideas or whatever, I tend to agree with you because I'm an atheist, but I feel that it's very alienating to people. And in particular in our culture, as we become more brown-skinned, I think that's going to be a big issue because there are a lot of people who are African-American and who are Latino who are very deeply ingrained in Christianity, and to try to come to some sort of consensus or agreement on important issues like a woman's right to choose, it's difficult to do that without acknowledging their belief system and trying to, you know, find somewhere where the groups can agree rather than only thinking about emphasizing the divergent points.
Yeah. I understand the point in that. I guess my outlook on how to fix the problems is to, a lot of times the root cause is completely divergent from religion, which is fine. But in religion, in issues where religion is a concern, woman's right to choose, health and sex education, which is the big one that's coming up right now, given the textbook hearings, science, which is getting really hammered by the current administration because it's not biblical, things like that. Going after specific doctrines and saying why they reject a woman's right to choose, for instance, I see as it's taking too fine a point on it. I would like to say that, look, the whole idea of religion doesn't make sense. Until you can prove that there is a God out there and that anything in the Bible has any validity to it,
Or the Quran. Or any of the sutras.
Any of the religious texts out there. Until you can prove that has some validity in our actual day-to-day life, let's put it aside and let's deal with actual reality. Let's deal with science and consequences.
And so does that mean that you believe the only validity is seeing is believing? That all truth comes from observation?
Through the scientific process, I think that would be a valid way of putting it. I guess I'm...
Okay, so with the scientific process, and this is exactly my point, because that's very positivistic. And so there are many ways of finding out, not just through the scientific process, not just through an experimental design. And there are also many questions that can't be answered by using the experimental design. I mean, if you think about educational research, you think about assigning random groups and trying to figure out, say, what reading method is more, you know,
effective,
beneficial to some groups of people, there are lots of pieces of that answer that will be left out if the only thing that you do is to study by experimental design.
Okay. So, I guess, what's the alternative?
Well, I think the alternative is to be a little bit more open-minded and to realize that, yes, seeing is believing is very important, and it is one way of gathering information, but there are other ways of gathering information too, like listening to people tell their stories and collecting those stories. And sometimes along the way, you're going to have to listen to people who are really religious.
Yeah.
I mean, even if you go back to the health issue.
But the problem with that is that when you're dealing with a scientific worldview, having anecdotal evidence doesn't really count for much. It's not proving
anything. That's because it's not prioritized by white men. I mean, the whole entire point that I'm making is exactly what you've just said. I mean, if you go back to the reading example, you can design an experimental study and you can find out in a in that design which reading method is more important. But if you go into the school system and you'll find that teachers aren't using the more effective system, you have to talk to them and gather that data as well to support the experimental design to see which method would in fact be most beneficial.
And not everything that's, you know, science depends on designing an experiment and carrying it out. We can look back at history and see what was done. You know, you don't need an experiment to prove that the Civil War happened. You can go back through history and look it up. You can
but
look
I do
at,
think that in general,
here's 15 different methods that have been used to teach kids to read. And we can see that in general, this one appears to do pretty well, this one, not so good. And so we can look back and see what's been tried, what are some new ideas out there, how do they fit in with what we already know, and kind of build off of that. But again, you're looking back at what has actually happened, what's real in this world, rather than just saying, well, I think that this would be a good way to do it, so let's do that.
That's true. There are many ways of gathering information. I mean, I was going to say, if you go back to the health issue and you consider Christian scientists or other ways of thinking, you'll also find out that people don't necessarily follow the Western ideas very well because of the ideas and values that they have embedded in the decisions that they make. And so all I'm really saying is that in terms of speaking about atheist perspective, I think it's really important to remember that because when you want people to receive you, you want to receive them with that same acceptance. And to me, a lot of times the perspectives that are presented are very closed-minded.
But if I might interject here, that suggests that every idea and every attitude out there is equally worthy of respect. Not every one of them is worth that.
I guess that's where you and I really, even though
no,
I am
if somebody
an atheist,
comes
that's
up,
where you and I really differ.
Well, no, if somebody comes up and says point blank, without question, if you don't do anything else for the rest of life, even if you do something for the rest of your life, you are damned and going to hell. That idea is just not worth considering. I mean, it's not even worth respecting such a person.
I guess I just don't think people are not worthy of respect.
And I didn't say people. I did not say a person, madam. I said an idea.
For example, is that one of the ways that you can find out where that's coming from is to find out about the experiences of other people that you don't necessarily share, which gets back to my point of race in this country and the legacy of slavery and the ties between slavery and Christianity.
Yeah, but we're not talking about people here. I mean, I can respect a person even if I think their ideas are completely ludicrous. If somebody comes to me and says they honestly, deeply, truly believe in Santa Claus, that's not something that I really have to respect. I mean, if this is a person who is rational in all their forms, I mean, assuming they're not three, again, I can go to them and say, you know, look, here's 150 reasons why that cannot simply exist. Now, if you're actually going to believe in Santa, that's just plain wrong. Not all ideas deserve respect. They deserve the amount of respect that they can back up with something to base it on. Just because it's an idea that came out of somebody's head doesn't mean that it deserves respect. Now, the person, perhaps, most likely, but the idea, not necessarily. If I have an idea,
that's completely
wrong. I understand
what you're saying in the extreme examples, like, you know, all people are damned to hell for doing nothing wrong or whatever, but I think it's also, what I'm really getting at is that you promote rationalism to the exclusion of anything else.
Okay. It's the best tool that we have to decide how to make rational decisions based in the world, to decide how we live our life. It's the best tool that we have. It's not the only tool, but it's the best one.
All right.
We didn't convince you. Okay. Did you have anything else for us? Apparently not.
What is an alternative to reason?
Okay. Again, there are other ways of looking at the world, other ways of trying to make decisions.
There's reacting entirely on emotion.
Exactly.
And entirely on dogma. And you can look at the White House to see how well that works.
Yeah, I mean, you can pick up the Bible and say, this is going to be my outlook on life. I'm going to follow it.
You can do tarot cards.
You're going to do some very strange things. Tarot cards, psychic readings, intuition. None of those really have a track record of actually being successful.
Bird droppings.
What?
There have actually been people who have examined bird entrails and bird droppings to get their clues to the future and react on that.
Okay, I mean, that's just nasty.
If we're going with alternatives, really, you need to consider all of them or you're being closed-minded, apparently, according to our last caller.
Yeah. And so, no, I don't agree that just having an idea means that that idea has some validity and it deserves respect. I don't necessarily think it does. And the reason that we may occasionally sound hard on this show and come out and say Christian, the whole Christian ideal or the idea of God is just plain wrong, and we just, you know, it's incorrect. We can be tough on it at times simply because we have been doing this show for a while. We heard of all the different arguments that, you know, there's a God because of this, that, and the other, and here's something you haven't considered. We've heard most of the arguments, and so we have come to this conclusion. Now, for a new viewer, that may be kind of shocking that you can all of a sudden come out and say, alternative medicine, completely bunk.
Mm-hmm.
Well, again, we've read quite a bit on it, and we have reason for saying that. So if you have questions on that specifically, then you can call us up. Which perhaps... Jay, how you doing? Jay?
That's been up there for a while.
That has been up there for a while. If you don't say anything in a couple seconds, we're hanging up on you.
Is it...
Hi, you there?
Me?
Yes.
Oh, I'm not Jam Tom.
I'm sorry. Okay, what you got for us?
Well, I just want to first thank you guys for being there. And actually, I really like your you being up there. You
Thank you.
Not only are you inclusive, you let everybody have their say.
Yeah.
You're very. You let all the other guests, you know, talk, and I really appreciate that. And
yeah. Try and open
anybody
up the floor.
Comes on your show and says they're an atheist is very brave. they get hammered.
Yeah. Well, it's not quite as bad. Side point, really quick. When the atheist community of Austin first started, it was I actually was not one of the original members. I came in early 2000. But apparently it was some people meeting in a bagel shop, kind of sitting in a corner, huddled together, kind of scared about if anybody actually found out that atheists were meeting in town.
They'd spit in your food.
Exactly. Christians would come down with machetes and knife us down or something like that.
Yeah.
And then somebody came up with the idea and said, hey, why don't we get a public access TV show going? And they kind of looked at him like he was nuts. Well, essentially we did, and... It's going rather well. It's not very often that we get people who are just completely ludicrous and coming down and making death threats or anything like that. Doesn't happen at all. So,
but what I did want to say is every now and then you do seem to come down on the side of pro-choice.
Okay.
And, you know, that's not really an atheist issue. That's a personal decision on when do you think a life is viable, you know?
Yeah. As the atheist experience, we're talking mostly about atheism, which is simply lack of belief in a God, period.
That has
end
nothing
of
to do when you think a life is viable.
Exactly. So being pro-life, pro-choice isn't really an atheist issue.
Exactly.
More atheists may be leaning this way than that, but technically it's not an atheist-related issue. I personally am pro-choice, but I've heard of a lot of arguments on the pro-life side that are not religiously based.
I can't make a decision on that because I'm an average white guy, you know, middle class, and
well, I don't.
We can't have opinions on that, but I'm just saying.
I disagree with that, but okay.
But anyway, I just want to thank you guys and keep it up.
Okay, right. Thanks a lot for calling. Yeah, I personally may be pro-choice, but I've heard a lot of arguments on both sides that are non-religious, and they do make some sense, and it's not a really big concern to me personally.
Well, and as so, somebody whom it does concern, I can assure you all of my arguments are entirely non-religious. And
well, I would hope so.
And 100% pro-choice.
Okay. So, but again, as you were saying... As the atheist experience, we are not saying that to be an atheist you must be pro-choice or a liberal or anything like that. You don't believe in God, you're an atheist. Get over it. let's go on to, let's see, Phil, are you there?
Yeah, I am. Hi, guys.
Okay, how you doing?
Just fine. I got, a programming question.
All right.
Probably going to be your shortest call today. Several weeks ago, I asked Mr. Glasser, his first name escapes me.
Russell.
I beg your pardon?
Russell. Mister?
Anyway, yeah, I asked Russell, I was on my usual rant about religious rights support for Israel, and he said that he was going to do a dissertation or a show or something about that. Is he still going to do that? Is that still on the calendar, or what's going on there?
That sounds vaguely familiar now that you're mentioning it.
Can you even speak for
Yeah, I haven't heard anything specifically.
Okay.
I could definitely get the message back to him and find out. Do you happen to know when that was? I mean, like 2 weeks ago or something?
I want to say 3 or 4 weeks ago, and he said he was going to do his show in about 3 or 4 weeks. So
okay, all right.
So I'm just wondering where we're at.
Well, he's on next in 2 weeks, and what we do is we have a calendar on our website at atheist-community.org, which does list the co-hosts, and when they have a topic prepared, it goes ahead and lists that as well.
Yeah. Cool. Thanks.
I'll definitely get in touch with him though and find out if you know he thought about that at all. So, but thank you for calling. all right, calendar. Let's go on to Jay. How you doing?
Good. How are you?
Yeah, pretty well. What you got for us?
Well, I guess first of all, the woman who called, I agreed with her quite a bit, and I thought that she was very, open-minded atheist, I suppose.
Okay.
But what I don't, first I'm going to touch on a few points, but I don't want to spend a lot of time on them.
Okay.
I think it's just important to get these points out for what you're saying.
All right.
All right, the homeopathy thing, well, let's take the culture that the homeopathy developed in, that would be the Asian culture, right? For the most part?
Was that?
No, it's worldwide phenomenon. The idea of sympathetic magic has existed in every culture.
Okay, well, that's been going on for how many years before modern medicine?
Yeah, yeah. Actually, homeopathy is based on, it's kind of loosely based on an idea which actually has scientific validity. The trouble is but that they take that and they ran with it a bit too far by a couple miles. Essentially, for people who don't know, quick description of homeopathy as I understand it.
Would you think that those ideas would have to be somewhat proven to be used if they've been going on for that long? The people who believe that, they're probably using stuff that has worked over the
years.
We don't
agree that religion has any validity. We don't believe that there's actually any God. But that's been around for even longer than homeopathy.
Yeah, the only thing an idea needs...
There's been a lot of beliefs out there.
Well, the only thing an idea or belief needs to survive is to not kill people. And if it has a completely neutral effect, if I give you a sliver of ginseng and some lemongrass and it doesn't kill you, well then, hey, it's going to go ahead and get passed on probably to other patients. Now, if I were to give you some Peladonna or some foxglove, some digitalis, well, you see, those ideas die really quick when it comes to using them as large groups, or excuse me, large amounts in homeopathy. You're just not going to see that because it has killed people. And so they know better.
All right, well, I guess the point is, I also see a contradiction in the gentleman, I forgot what your name was.
Me? Ashley.
You believe in a woman's right to choose, you said?
Yes.
Okay, so
again,
you believe fetus is not we'll talk about the parents' rights, religious parents, to not allow their children to be treated by conventional medicine, and they will die.
Okay.
What's the difference between abortion and that?
Oh, let me.
I don't understand. Do you just believe the fetus is not...
Once a child is capable of living on its own after it's been given birth, it could be adopted off to a different family, medical things,
could do that
and
if it
stuff
was...
like that. Yes, but...
You're saying as long as it's still part of the woman, it's her right to choose because it's...
Well, I wouldn't say quite that long, but early on, it is not a thinking, feeling, conscious human being. And so if we can see that there's a really good chance that this kid is going to be messed up in some way because the mom, you know, is on drugs and there's just, you know, a whole bunch of problems that can be foreseen, that if this kid comes in the world, it's going to cause even more problems. I can't see any real strong reason to say that they should not have the right to say, let's have an abortion. Now, later on, then you can say, if a kid's 5 years old, I don't say, well, you know, things have gone bad, sorry, Billy, we got to kill you. That's a solution to our problem. There are other solutions out there, which could be same for, again, pregnancies.
Okay, so as an atheist, just a question on atheist, like the actual concept, it's not a religion, right?
Yeah, correct.
Is natural law like the basis of what you would believe in? Because it would seem to me that if you have certain beliefs, I guess as an atheist, each individual has the right to believe whatever they want as long as it goes along with the concept of atheist, being an atheist?
No, you have the right to believe whatever you want.
The only
regardless
thing
of how intelligent
God,
or wacky it is.
Is that the only rule of being an atheist?
Well, there are no rules. Atheism is a lack of belief in a God.
Okay.
That's it.
I guess what I don't see is there seems to be a lot of concepts that you guys tend to stand behind.
That can kind of go along with it. Scientific naturalism is one of them.
Okay, see, naturalism.
Okay.
Let's say, take a wolf back, for instance, okay? New wolf pups. One of them's injured, doesn't survive. Do you not see us as part of the natural kingdom or whatever? I mean,
I don't see us as being some kind of special above nature or anything like that.
All right. Well, I guess what I don't understand is why do you feel that the need to express these beliefs on other people if you don't believe in God, but you believe that it's important to keep people alive or give people...
A reason for the show. We think that this show is important because other people with religious ideas are out there pushing their beliefs on everyone else. They're saying, because God commandeth thus, then we should write into law thus. And if they don't have a really good reason for saying that God exists and that law is a really good idea, then they really need to think about that. That is a big issue that we have.
Yeah, I'm not a religious person at all, really. But I wouldn't call myself an atheist because I think that's still labeling yourself something. You're putting a category on yourself.
You know, well, sir, do you believe that a God exists?
To me, it's no different than religion when you think about it.
But sir, do you believe that a God exists?
I don't really believe that a God exists as defined or that
could
be defined like that, but I do believe that there's a force bigger than... science to me, I guess you would be my God. You know what I mean? Like nature.
Yeah, but we already have a word for that called science.
Energy, nature. I mean, there's a driving force behind everything grows on this planet.
But that's biology and physics.
In chemistry, that has nothing
chemistry,
to do with
biology,
it.
Physics, yeah.
Where did that come from to begin with?
God typically implies some conscious, supernatural entity.
Do you believe that there are things that we don't understand or know about the creation of the universe?
Yes.
Sir, you're using the word creation, which is actually begging the question.
Yeah, we don't know
everything.
Well,
okay, creation.
Agreed.
Development, whatever, the growth, whatever the scientific... Okay.
However you want to put it,
evolution,
there are things...
Evolution of the universe?
Yeah, there are things about this world which we don't have an answer to yet.
Okay.
I will agree with that. Science is looking into it.
However, a few years ago, there were more things we didn't know, and a few years before that, there were still more. As time goes on, we learn more and more. We do not have to use God as some sort of a spackle to smooth over the areas that we're just not familiar with. We are willing to say we don't know now, but we have confidence that we will, if not in our lifetime, in another lifetime.
Another generation. I think the whole concept of not believing in a God would be that any of the things that you believe in would not to interfere with the natural law or to do good, all these things, or why do you feel this way? Why do you feel the need to do that? And what has determined within you what is right and what is wrong? What I mean?
It's a simple analysis. If Ashley were to suddenly collapse from a horrible heart attack, of course we would all help him on the assumption that if something horrible would have happened to us, people would come and help us. Obviously, if you just blow off a person who needs help, there's no reason to expect that you're going to need help. It's a very selfish evolution.
Okay,
and that would be why it came into civilization in the first place.
The instinct within us and the way we've developed the ability to rationalize things or interpret and analyze, this is bad because I hit this person, this is bad because I see them show pain, and then I won't do that again. That's how I rationalize that.
Mm-hmm.
Where did the ability to the feeling to care about hurting them or any of those things come from?
Evolution.
Because if you don't, then chances are everyone else who likes that person is going to come and thump on you.
All right.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's basically payback helps. It kind of what drives society. If I go around just saying, I don't really care about all these laws because... they're not helping me, and so I can steal whatever car I want, get whatever money I want, hurt anybody I want. Well, chances are the law's going to come back and, pull me away because I'm causing problems.
And
problems for everybody.
That's a fun example of that.
I don't understand how you can't see the ongoing cycle in every response you have. I could have the most... vague and natural philosophical answer to, like, response to you. So where does the ability, why you want to keep your species going, where does that come from? The need to keep surviving if you don't believe and there's a God.
Just because you can keep asking questions, I mean, what doesn't is the reason for living?
The reason for living. The reason for living is whatever meaning you choose to give it. I happen to like, you know, summer days and kitty cats, and I'm going to be alive as long as I've got my cats around because I like taking care of them. I was alive for a while to take care of my dad. I was nursed him for 18 months straight as he died.
Why do you like doing that?
Why do I like doing that?
Why do you like cats instead of ferrets or gerbils or...
I love rodents.
Snakes,
rodents are great. You're going to have to go further than that. You took care of an iguana at one point.
What's your point?
Yeah, so what is your point?
How are you different from this person? You have things that you like and you enjoy that are
you're an individual, right?
That define you.
You're trying to go for individuality. You think somehow belonging to a mass hive conscience that worships a god makes you an individual?
Well, do you not believe that people are different?
Of course people are different.
What do you think defines that?
That is your physiology and your brain chemistry.
Right,
that's what happens.
All cats are different also. I don't see the point. You have different genetics, which gives you different predispositions. You were raised in different environments, which gives you different outlooks on life. I'm going to be different than everybody else because the factors that went into making me who I am right now are different from you and my co-host and everybody else in the world.
And in fact, in cloning animals, it's also been proven that a cloned animal will be completely different from its host if it's brought up in a different environment at different times and in different manners.
Would two humans be that way?
Oh, certainly.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Would two humans be that way?
Yeah. I mean, it's not guaranteed, but it's
actually
a really good chance.
Look at twins. What is it? Fraternal twins? Identical twins? Those are actually one egg split in two. That's as close to clones as people are going to get. Mm. Until the religious people back off, of course. And they are different. You're not going to find identical twins who are actually literally identical, physically or mentally.
I think that every response you guys have can be answered with a question.
Well, yeah, you know, but that's not a sign of knowledge,
though. That you're an atheist is that you don't believe in those questions. So that's really no different than any other religious concept.
There's no such thing as not believing in a question.
Just because you have a question doesn't mean that that's knowledge, though. Knowledge, you know, questions don't imply knowledge. Questions imply lack of knowledge. We have rational, reasonable explanations for why people are good to each other. Why we can explain the world the way it is without resorting to some supernatural deity. We have answers for these things. We don't have answers for everything, but we have a process in place that most likely will give us an answer in time. And so while we don't know exactly what started the universe, for instance, right now, chances are in a while we may, or we'll have at least a better idea.
All right, just one more thing, and then I'll get off so somebody else can talk. It seems rather unintelligent to me to, the creation of the, no, I don't know what he's creation again, okay, the evolution of the universe from wherever we know it first began, or the theories say.
Okay.
Even if you trace that back as far as you can, like hypothetically speaking, that we found out how this all came about, does it not make logical sense based on the methods of scientific study we have that there has to be some sort of ingredient in order for something to like a chemical reactions or whatever, this or that, in order for things to...
To start off the Big Bang, you mean?
Well, I mean, like, Big Bang. What about before the Bang?
We don't know.
Mm-hmm. You don't know. I know,
they're still working on that.
Yeah.
I just want to ask you, what is your logical, intelligent mind? As an intelligent person, how do you...
That's a
just
little...
accept that was that, and when you look beyond that...
That's in the realm of science. That's in the realm of science, not logic. Logic is not going to tell you a lot of the scientific
that's a good
process
answer,
of the world. Scientific isn't going to tell you logical things about how things work. They're two slightly different fields that can overlap at times. We don't know exactly what started the universe.
But what does your logic tell you as a rational person with
what are
an
my
intelligent person?
What is my personal idea?
How do you accept the fact that do you think that there's just some sort of continuous rhythm to things? And
that's one of the theories.
That's one of the theories. We don't know. The scientific world is sitting there. They've got a whole bunch of different theories about how things started and why they work the way that they work. They're kind of battling it out to see which one makes more sense and which one is more supported by evidence. Once they have an answer,
the energy that exists, even if it always existed... That's just a concept. I mean, that's impossible in a rational way, when you think in a logical way.
Why?
Sir, what's your background in physics and cosmology? How thoroughly have you studied these subjects?
I'm a wine cook. I don't know anything about this. I smoke a lot of pot and took too much acid, okay?
That's not a good way to make decisions about the world, then.
Nor is it a good way to learn.
Probably not, but that's not your place to really say. I mean, you're entitled to your opinion, but I just feel like you guys are a little bit narrow-minded in some of your thinking, and that some of the things that you want to... the way you feel as an atheist, or you kind of limit yourself in opening your mind up to another concept and outside and actually thinking about it. You know what I mean? And then
we're open to other ideas, but a lot of these
and all the concepts that you believe now. If you say you believe four or five things that are somewhat similar and define or prove this, somebody opens your idea up to another concept that is completely opposite or quite different than that. Do you not feel that those things, based on those part of your frame of reference, which we just determined...
If that new view explains...
You're going to limit yourself, though, aren't you?
Well, not exactly. If we have a whole bunch of theories backing up... I'll take evolution, for instance. That say, here's all these different data points that we have that point towards evolution. If somebody comes along and says, no, look, God did it. Or here's a completely different theory that you didn't think of before. This is what actually did it. Okay, you've presented an explanation for how things got to the way they are. Now, if it explains all the other pieces of evidence that we have in a better way than we currently have, then this is a really good idea that we should look into a lot closer. But typically they don't do that. They will offer an explanation. God did it, poof. Okay, so what about genetic evidence? What about the fossil records and stuff like that?
No, I believe in evolution completely.
I know, and I'm just using that as an example. I'm not saying you personally. I'm saying as an example.
Yeah.
They will just say that God put everything here as is, poof. There you go. They've explained how things got here, but they haven't explained all the genetic similarities, the fossil records, things like that.
I agree with you. That's a caveman way of thinking.
They don't offer all those explanations. Therefore, that's an idea that we can just reject.
I completely agree with you on that.
So a lot of other ideas will work the same way to reject them.
I don't have a problem with you exposing people to your thoughts. I didn't hear you. What did you say?
A lot of other ideas that are presented we can reject in the same way.
Yeah,
they don't
sure.
explain everything else that we know, and so they can be rejected outright also.
I agree with you completely on that, and religion is a caveman way of thinking. Man needed an explanation for death or a reason to, you know, rationalize life and death and created a god, obviously. And to abide by the rules of
people who wrote that or talk like... So do you have something specific, then?
But it's based on an underlying concept, and that is, like, it's based on a reason for us to live. And if you look at all the religions, they're all quite similar. And I tend to think that yours is a little bit similar, too, even though it's not completely opposite, though the concept is, nevertheless, it's something you believe in. It's your way of defining or rationalizing your life here.
Yeah. But it's based on a logical outlook on life. It's based on a scientific process that has a proven track record of working.
Yeah, and maybe you're just a more highly evolved human being with a greater intelligence or ability to explain things like that. But nevertheless, you still, it's the same mental process or whatever. You are explaining your existence here in a way. You're rationalizing it. Yeah. Are you not? And that's what religion does for a lot of people. And yeah, I think that to... base your thoughts on a book that was written however many hundred years or thousands of years ago is ridiculous, you know? I mean, we've come a long way since then. People are a lot smarter and can explain a lot more things.
So, yeah, we look at the scientific process to say science has provided explanations for these things, and we think that they're pretty good explanations. They're backed up by a lot of evidence. We have a lot of reason to believe that they're true.
So,
therefore, the scientific process that came up with these ideas in the first place, chances are it's a really good way of deciding how the world works and how to make decisions.
Yeah, I agree with you completely, and I think you guys are like 98% of the way there. But the reason I wouldn't call myself an atheist is because, let's see. When you hug somebody or when you tell somebody they did a good job or when you do this, it makes them feel good, it makes you feel good.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
How do you feel when you do that? Don't lie to yourself. I mean, don't narrow your... You know, be honest with me. How do you feel? Have you ever been in love or thought you were in love?
Yeah.
Okay.
Just because you can't bottle it doesn't mean that it's not real.
You know, but honestly, what feeling goes through you when you share those moments with another person or, you know?
I mean, that's an emotional thing. I'm missing your point.
Hmm. Do you not think... Okay, basically, you're nice to somebody, right? They have a good day, so they're nice to somebody at their job who's in return nice to some... Do you think that happens? I mean, that even other events?
Yeah.
And that's what evolution
is. Payback, good and bad.
Negative things affect it negatively too, right?
Yeah. Again, I mean, payback is a real thing.
I know all human beings have the capability to feel, and I know when you hug somebody, you feel something that's satisfying, and you feel a little energy in your chest and your body when you get a good hug, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you honestly think that that comes from you've evolved to, you know what I mean?
It's the best explanation that we have, yeah. Outside of souls or spirits or mystical energies, it's the best explanation, yes. I mean, brain chemistry and evolution is what say that when you do something good, you feel good about it.
Are there...
Why anyway, do we put, I think we're going to have to...
Why do we put people that kill people in prison instead of just kill them, you know what I mean? Or why do we...
Because we have decided that killing people is a bad idea.
Well, Christians would
partly.
Some of it... No, there's some atheists think that killing people is a bad idea, and some think that the death penalty would be okay, I guess, or...
Yeah, again, that's not really an atheist... specific issue. There are some Christians who say that they should be killed, and some that say that they shouldn't.
But it would be okay for someone who was an atheist to have that view.
If they have some kind of rational reason for backing it up, and they can convince others, then...
But there is a rational reason for both of those in a way.
Yeah, and if they're irrational, then it's not a very good reason.
But the only thing that determines whether it's rational is the difference between person's views and the way that, you know what I mean?
Not necessarily.
If you agree with one or the other,
if you can back it up with some kind of real world evidence or consequence or something like that, then it's more than just a good idea. So,
okay.
But I think we're going to let you go here. I mean, we've got other callers lined up.
Yeah, that's cool.
But thanks a lot for calling in. Like I said, if you've got any other questions, give us a call some other time.
Yeah, enjoy yourself.
Okay, thanks, Sean. All right.
He was all over the map there.
All right, let's go on to Karen. How are you doing?
I'm fine. How are you?
Not too bad. What you got for us?
Good. Well, first of all, I just wanted to... I was not raised in a constructed religious environment.
Okay.
I consider myself a devout agnostic.
Okay.
So I just had a couple of questions for you guys quickly. What is your educational, personal, professional background that kind of brings you to where you are today and to speak on this matter? Secondly, what would you believe would be, what do you think it's going to take for human beings to be able to live a life and a good life and that without having to look to some higher deity to explain that or rationalize that? You know what I mean by that question?
I think so.
One third thing I was going to have you touch on just is what do you believe the... are there any kind of type of common theories among atheists that of our creation or the beginning, or is there any common theories from you?
All right. To go in order, personal background and education. I've had some college. It's not anything based on any theology or science or anything like that, economics. I was actually raised in a religious home, Catholic, went to church every week and that type of thing, until about 11th grade. I guess I don't have any formal education or background or anything to be able to be hosting a show on atheism, but I don't believe in a god, so I guess that's something. I have done quite a bit of reading on it, on philosophies and ideas, religious history, religious ideas, that type of thing, rational arguments and such. And so that's why I don't believe that there are any gods. But that's my story, I guess.
And you're sticking with it.
Damn right.
Okay, and... myself, I've got, I actually entered college as a sophomore because I took all the advanced placement tests.
Nerd.
So I do have a, yes. And all of it was in foreign languages. So I do have a BA in history, but that has, again, as Ashley said, nothing to do with position on atheism. My family was Catholic, but I've never once in my life believed there was any kind of a God. I stopped saying the pledge when I was in first grade because I objected to the phrase under God. I never thought there was a Santa Claus. I have such a wonderful imagination that when I hear people talking about these things, I immediately pegged it for what it was, which was just a fairy tale. And it never occurred to me that people took it serious. And I think I was about 5 years old when I realized people in church were there because they really thought that their little buddy was real. And that was a strange epiphany that day.
I like the style, Linda.
Next one was how to live a good life, I guess, ideas on such. I'm coming more to grips now. The old host of the show used to say actions.
Let me kind of clarify that.
And okay.
I guess my question is that I've pondered is, and this is the way, you know, I like to live. I consider myself a good person without having to kind of worry about what's going to happen to me after I die.
Yeah.
So my question is, how do we, you know, what's it going to take for, let's say, all human beings to kind of live that way, and why cannot we live that way?
Okay.
I have a theory on that.
Go for it, then.
Okay, for so much of human civilization, for almost our entire history, up until about 200 years ago, we were so utterly dependent on each other that no person could literally survive alone. For instance, these days, you could go for weeks without seeing another human, or without interacting with another human. You have ATMs, you have your little automatic gas, you have this and that. But while we all live together as a group, we are dependent on external things to survive, as it were. I hope this is not being too fuzzy. And in the West, in fact, everywhere there's a religion, people are taught that they have to look outside themselves for survival, for their source of morality, because we've just come up in a civilization where you had to do that. But now we can actually survive with the bet we had the better education. Oh, this is getting awfully fuzzy. But the thing is, if we could just teach people that you don't have to lean on somebody else in order to be a good person, that you can actually look inside of yourself, you have your own morality, or a morality that's actually accepted by society, that you yourself are not inherently evil, all of those things have to be overcome before we can become less religious, less leaning on a deity or a demiurge of any sort.
I'd like to say that education is a big part of it, and be able to go to people and say, hopefully open up their minds and say, look, there's doubt to whether or not God exists. And so we have some rules to live by in life that are based on actions that have consequences. If you kill somebody, that's really bad for them and their family and their friends and everybody else in society.
Well, yeah,
I'm going somewhere with this. So just let me ride. But we have a rational and a reasonable basis for why we have a good life and why we don't need a God for that good life. Now, the education part comes in as in there are a couple different choices on how to have an outlook on life. You can either believe in God and believe that you shouldn't kill because, well, he said so. Or, since we don't really know that God exists for sure, here's a better reason for why God doesn't, or for why killing is a bad thing. And we think this reason makes a lot more sense other than just because, well, he's the one with the more power.
Yeah, I
think that's reasonable.
So. Right, and it's reasonable that, you know, couldn't we actually become more of a moral society when we do not depend on the fear to keep us from doing the things that we inherently know are not moral?
I think so,
moral.
Because we have a rational
idea. And I do believe there are, we do inherently know what's moral and what's not, I mean, basically.
Yeah, I think we would have. I think it would be a better society just because we'd have a rational reason to live life the way we do, rather than basing it just on, well, he's really big and powerful and scary.
Yeah, so. It's like, you know, the last caller, I think what he was trying to say to you was, you know, how do you know that a hug feels good? And, you know, I was not raised in a religious family, you know, never was taught that a hug was good. But I know a hug feels good.
Yeah.
I know, you know, I have friends that are Catholics, Christians, you know, Jews, whatever. That also, I think the hugs pretty much feel the same to all of us for the reason because it just feels good.
Yeah.
Just curious about that. I appreciate that. And like the show.
Okay. Thanks a lot for calling.
Bye.
Bye. Also, one other thing we forgot to go over, origin of the universe and stuff, atheist theories on that.
Well, she said life specifically, didn't she?
We need to look at
I'm not sure. But regardless, the answer is going to be pretty much the same. Atheism is simply lack of belief in a God. There's no atheist doctrine or dogma that says you must believe so.
So it's pretty much whatever is the prevailing scientific theory, and I believe panspermia has become very respectable. They've got evidence that that is possibly how life first came to Earth.
Yeah.
That's the theory that little bacteria, or maybe even, I guess it'd be just bacteria, or at least single-cell organisms, came to Earth on comets and on meteorites.
Well, I've actually heard not even bacteria or anything quite that advanced, but more just the organic molecules.
That's true, yeah. You can have just plain organic molecules as well.
So, but basically, the answer comes down to it's not technically an atheist issue, and our answer would be, if we don't know, well, we don't know, we're looking into it. Mm-hmm. Science doesn't have a firm 100% explanation saying life began this way. So until we do, we're not positive, we're looking into it, we've got some ideas, get back to us in a little while, we'll find out.
Well, just pretty sure it wasn't a god with Plato.
That's one of the theories that's a little bit lower on the list, yeah. All right, let's go on to Timmy. How you doing?
Hi.
Okay.
Hi, Ashley.
Yep.
Do you know the definition of atheist?
Lack of a belief in a god.
Okay. Well, do you know the definition of a religion?
Religion usually involves some kind of organized worship of some supernatural power.
Okay.
It gets a little fuzzy on the border sometimes, but usually that's what it involves.
Do you consider atheist religion a religion?
No, because we don't have any kind of formalized beliefs. We don't worship any kind of supernatural or higher power. There's no God or anything like that to worship in atheism.
But you don't believe in God.
Exactly. We don't believe in God, so it's not a religion.
Oh. Okay, and Linda?
Yes?
You're fat and ugly.
You're dropped.
I knew it was that same little child from last week.
Last week?
And the week before.
Little punks calling in.
Mm-hmm.
Go back to school. All right, we have got Andrew, how you doing?
Hey, guys. I'm doing okay.
Yeah, what's up?
I wanted to touch upon something one of the earlier callers had said, sort of the open-minded versus closed-minded atheism.
Okay.
And I could see some of her point because
just turn this down.
I think it's important, but then it's sort of the cultural relativist in me, which is also at play. But I think it's important not to necessarily dismiss something outright just because it may be associated with a religion, whether it be Eastern, whatever. You know, I think it's important to at least consider it and, of course, subject it to scientific scrutiny and see if there may be some basis behind it. And, I mean, even when religion is...
Also, just a second.
Sure.
We are going to need a little more volume in here at Control Room. It's getting really quiet in here. So, sorry. Anyway, continue.
And I would just say that it's important not to necessarily dismiss things outright just because they're associated with religion.
Oh, no. I understand your point there. Some specific ideas we can dismiss outright because they have absolutely no backing. Again, if somebody just wants to come up and says God did it all because he just felt like it, that's an idea that we can pretty much dismiss outright. Now, just because it's a religious idea isn't the reason that we can dismiss it. We can dismiss it because we have lots and lots and lots and lots and lots of other pieces of evidence and ideas out there to back up why things are the way that they are. No, just because it's a religiously born idea doesn't mean that you can dismiss it outright. There are a lot of religiously born ideas which are absolutely true. So,
like eating raw pork is bad.
Some not so much. does that kind of sort of answer it or not?
Yeah, I just wanted to sort of, get that out there that of course no one speaks for all atheists, but I didn't want people to assume that we simply dismiss something because, oh, that's a religious belief. I mean, no.
Yeah, no.
We certainly take them into consideration and hopefully apply some sort of empirical method to them to see if they can be tested, proven, and there may be some basis behind them.
Exactly. You know? There have been a couple studies out there on the efficacy of prayer in healing somebody. They're actual scientific double-blind studies and stuff like that. That means that somebody came up with the idea that, hey, why don't we pray for people and see if that helps them? other people went out and said, okay, let's try it out and see what happens, did experiments on it and found that doesn't really do all that much. That was a religiously based idea that we came out and we tested, found that it doesn't really work, and therefore now we say, well, prayer, not going to probably do anything if you're trying to help somebody heal. So that's one instance of where, like you say, we don't just reject it outright because it's religious. We sat down and did some tests on it, found that there was a good reason for rejecting it. So, all right.
Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay, thanks for calling. All right, we've had about 5 minutes left, and I believe that we can go ahead and take one or two more callers. Joe, how you doing?
I was thinking just before this show, just before I switched to this show, I find it hard to understand how anybody can not show human decency, and I believe that to be God, what God is. But then on behalf of that God that I believe the goodness in people, I apologize for that last female caller. Her closing remark was about as just put me on. I felt total shame that, you know, why is she, how can anybody be that way? But anyway, I want to thank you. How can God be denied? Except for ladies like that last caller.
How could we deny God? Or
yeah, in essence, I guess that's
fine. Why don't we believe in God?
Yeah.
We haven't seen any evidence out there presented for God to exist. It's an idea that some people had. We don't see any evidence for it.
Yeah, I agree.
Well, in my sight, it's that it's just something that is. God just is.
That okay, but do you have any reasons to back that up rather than just, well, God is?
Because so there's some element on this planet, some quality like oxygen or carbon or something like that. There's some element on this planet that urges some of us to be decent.
That's morality, not oxygen.
And that's also a product of one's environment, of one's brain chemistry, and of how one is brought up, one's nurture.
Right.
When you're presented with different theories, you have to have some kind of way of testing and deciding which is the better of the two. A lot of people come up and say, well, God created things the way that they are. I could say that an infinitely powerful hippopotamus farted the universe out 2,000 years ago, and created everything the way it is right now.
Yeah.
They both have the same validity until you start saying, okay, well, let's look for actual evidence for one or the other, or scientific creation, whatever. We have more evidence to back up the idea of science creating it, and the Big Bang, and evolution, and cosmology, physics, biology, chemistry, all kind of stuff. We have things to back that up. Hippopotamus, you have an idea, not too much to back it up. The idea of an infinite God that created it, not too much to back it up.
Granted, actually, there's science. Science runs a lot of what we believe, what's discovered, and that's, in a sense, that's God.
Well, science is science. We have a word for that, and science kind of fits in there nicely.
Okay.
When you take God and you shove it in that hole, you're bringing a lot of baggage along with it that doesn't really deserve to be there.
So why don't we just leave off attention to God as a being and direct our attention to health?
To science? We're all for that.
Health. I mean, and to be healthy, to encourage other people to be healthy, that's the spirit. That's a real pretty sacred spirit of the species.
Actually, a lot of people who believe in God are trying to do just the opposite of that. They're the ones protesting proper science textbooks and the health textbooks. They're the ones against the Christian scientists, the ones against medicine.
Yeah.
So a belief in God is not necessarily promoting healthy living.
Yeah. And we're going to let you go with that because we've got about 30 seconds left.
Thank you so much.
Thanks a lot for calling
in. Thanks for calling.
Bye. As for anybody else who's left on the line, thank you very much for calling. Sorry we didn't get to you. Anybody else who's on the line or watching, we have an email address, tv@atheist-community.org. If you got any questions, if you didn't get on the air or something like that, go ahead and write us and we'll respond to you via email. And if we've got something good, we'll come back and read it on the air next week. Again, we'll be back next week. Thanks, everybody, for watching. Hope y'all have a great week.
And I believe it'll be Don as the co-host next week. Don Baker?
I believe, yes, Don will be the co-host. Goodbye.